Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, or SNAP, in schools, hosted by the Food Research and Action Center. I'm Steve Hayward, FRAC's Communications Manager. Before we begin, I'd like to cover a few brief housekeeping items. We expect this webinar to run about 60 minutes. We are recording the presentation and will send the recording and slides to everyone who registered in a follow-up email. Feel free to introduce yourself and your organization in the chat. We'll have time for questions and answers at the end of the presentation. To ask a question at any time during the webinar, please use the Q&A panel. While captions are not available through this webinar platform, many common browsers can generate automated captions. For details on turning yours on, follow the link in the announcements panel in the bottom left hand of the platform. With that, I'll pass it off to Aaron Kennedy Heisem, Senior Child Nutrition Policy Analyst at FRAC. Take it away, Aaron.
Thanks, Steve, and welcome everyone to FRAC's Thursday webinar, SNAP in Schools. For those of you who may be unfamiliar with FRAC, we are the Food Research and Action Center, a national nonprofit advocacy organization that works to eradicate hunger in the United States through strengthening and supporting the federal nutrition programs. We do this through three main ways: research, training and technical assistance, and advocacy. I'm so excited to be here today. We have a jam-packed agenda with a slew of phenomenal speakers who are willing to share what they're doing to increase SNAP utilization and to conduct SNAP outreach in schools and their local communities. I'm going to start by giving a little bit of a background on the connection between SNAP and school meals, essentially why we're here and why we're talking about this. And then I'll pass it over to our speakers. First, we'll hear from Francesca DiGiorgio from Hunger Solutions New York, then Chelsea Novak from the Greater Pittsburgh Community Food Bank, and Isosa Udu from Hunger Free Oklahoma. We'll come back to talk some resources and some advocacy efforts, and then we'll open it up to Q&A. You can enter your questions at any time throughout this webinar by using the Q&A feature on the left-hand side of your screen. So just yesterday, USDA released the latest Household Food Security Report, which confirms some of our worst fears. Without greater investments in anti-poverty and anti-hunger programs, food insecurity in America continues to grow. In 2023, 47.4 million Americans faced food insecurity. That means that for the second year in a row, Americans have struggled to meet the food and nutritional needs of their families, and that's just not okay. The rate for children and the trends that we see in children living in food insecure households is the same. In 2023, 13.8 million children lived in a household struggling with hunger and food insecurity. And as you can see here, that is a significant increase from 2021, when pandemic-related policies provided greater support to American families. The increase in food insecurity in America in 2023 was driven by inflation and a rollback of those critical policies, such as expanded SNAP benefits, healthy school meals for all, and the expanded child tax credit. All of these policies helped families put food on their tables and in their bellies. Federal nutrition programs are crucial in the fight against hunger and food insecurity. And that is why we're here today, to talk about the two largest nutrition assistance programs, the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, known as SNAP, and the National School Lunch and School Breakfast Programs. We know that food insecurity is driven by poverty and underemployment. Research shows that SNAP helps lift people out of poverty, allowing them to stretch their financial resources a little further. We know it isn't enough, but it helps. SNAP has been shown to generate economic activity as well. So what does that really mean? Research shows that it is estimated every dollar of SNAP benefits generates $1.50 to $1.80 in economic activity. Research has also connected SNAP participation, particularly utilization in early childhood, to improved graduation rates, adult earnings, and adult health. And similar research on school meals has been shown to do the same. Participation in school meals, particularly in the Community Eligibility Provision, or CEP, strengthens household food security. When children are able to receive a healthy meal at school at no cost, their family's food budget stretches even further. School meals have been shown to support learning and academic achievement. Research correlates school breakfast participation in particular with improvements in school attendance, improved student behavior, and improved standardized test scores, particularly math. And we know school meals are some of the healthiest meals that children receive. And with USDA's updated nutrition standards rolling out over the next few school years, they're about to get even healthier. Research shows that children who eat school meals have higher intakes of micronutrients of public health concern, which is just a very wordy, long way to say children who eat school meals have a higher intake of vitamin A, C, D, calcium, potassium, fiber, and more. And the benefits for both of these programs go on and on, because a well-nourished society is a productive society. So what's the connection really between school meals and SNAP? Why are we talking about that today? And it really comes down to school meal eligibility. In order to qualify for a free or a reduced price school meal, the child is determined eligible in either one of two ways. They either submit a household meal benefit application or a school meals application, or they are determined eligible for free school meals via participation in another means-tested program. So through the household application, families submit a form to the school that is then collected, processed, and verified by the school district. That form indicates the number of people in the household as well as the household income. If their income falls within the federal guidelines, they may qualify for a free or reduced price meal. For children who are categorically eligible, what happens is a data matching process called direct certification. And direct certification takes data from participation in other programs such as SNAP, TANF, FDPIR, or Medicaid, and matches it to school enrollment records to automatically qualify these children as eligible for free school meals without the need of an application. So direct certification has a lot of benefits, but schools are required to directly certify children in households that participate in SNAP. Many, many schools, if not most schools, directly certify students in all of the eligible categories, TANF, FDPIR, children who are experiencing homelessness, et cetera. But they must do it according to the regulations with SNAP, and it must be done at least 3 times a year. Although it is a benefit to both the student and the school district, the more frequently that direct certification occurs. USDA has set state level benchmarks for states across the country at 95%. Meaning that USDA hopes that every state aims to get to 95% or exceed 95% of SNAP matching, meaning that 95% of children within a state who are on SNAP are also being matched for free school meals. As I mentioned, direct certification has numerous benefits. Some of our speakers are going to get into these today, but just to touch on them on a high level, direct certification eliminates school meal applications, thus reducing that paperwork burden on families. It reduces the administrative burden associated with processing that paperwork. It links eligible children to school meals benefits and improves the financial viability of CEP. So for those of you who might not be familiar with CEP, otherwise known as the Community Eligibility Provision, I'm going to talk about it just quickly so that we give our presenters enough time to share. But basically, a school is eligible to participate in CEP, meaning that they are able to offer all their students school meals at no cost if at least 25% of their enrollment is directly certified. In CEP schools, these children are called identified students. So if at least 25% of the student population is directly certified or identified students, the school can opt into CEP and offer all students, school meals at no charge. There are a lot of benefits to CEP. I won't jump into all of them here, but I encourage you to visit our website, read our reports, review our previous webinars to learn more. What I do want to point out, however, is that CEP adoption, meaning the number of schools that are electing to participate in CEP, has grown tremendously over the last decade. Students, families, and schools understand the benefits of offering healthy meals to all students. CEP increases meal participation, eases administrative and operational burdens, improves student health and academic achievement, and it fights food insecurity. Schools are reimbursed for meals served based on their identified student percentage. So the higher a school's ISP, meaning the more children that they can directly certify or deem automatically eligible for free school meals, the more federal dollars the school receives to operate nutrition programs. And this is where SNAP outreach really comes in. The more children a school can directly certify, the higher their ISP, the more likely they are to implement CEP and offer all students healthy school meals at no charge. Over 40,000 schools implemented CEP in the 2022-2023 school year. Nearly 50% were schools with the highest ISPs, meaning they received the highest level of federal reimbursement. Starting this school year, the CEP adoption threshold dropped from 40% to 25%, meaning even more schools will be eligible to implement CEP. However, without additional funding sources, it will be exceptionally challenging to implement CEP in schools at lower eligibility levels. And with that, I would like to turn it over to our first speaker, Francesca.
Good afternoon. To start, I'd just like to thank Erin and the rest of the FRAC team for your efforts to coordinate this webinar and just for the opportunity to join the conversation. I also want to recognize and especially thank any attendees on this call providing direct assistance, working on the front lines to support individuals and families facing food insecurity and navigating the SNAP application process is such admirable work, and it's also challenging work. We know SNAP has always been vital to safeguarding our communities against hunger, so thank you again for being here and for your dedication to that work. I can share a bit now about Hunger Solutions New York. We're a statewide anti-hunger organization based out of Albany, and our mission is to maximize participation in and support for the federally funded nutrition assistance programs, including SNAP, as well as WIC, the school breakfast and lunch programs, as well as the Community Eligibility Provision, the Child and Adult Care Food Program and its after-school meal components, and last but not least, the summer nutrition programs, including summer meals and summer EBT. Our small and nimble team works on all of these programs to maximize participation. Generally, we work more at the systems level with institutions like schools and libraries and CBOs, rather than one-on-one with clients, though we have certain staff that do, and more on that shortly. I'll share now about the scope of our SNAP outreach work here in New York State. Our organization holds a contract with our state agency to manage what's called the Nutrition Outreach and Education Program, abbreviated NOAP. We subcontract to CBOs across the state to provide one-on-one assistance to improve participation in SNAP among New Yorkers, as well as referrals to other assistance programs. The service is free and it's confidential. To put the impact of the NOAP program into numbers, last year, the program helped over 32,000 New York households successfully apply for SNAP and get the food that they need. What we value as a statewide organization subcontracting to CBOs doing this work is the opportunity to center local voices in outreach and leverage existing networks. These folks understand their communities best, how to speak with them, who the trusted points of contact are, and the most effective channels of communication. And often, SNAP outreach is just one complementary piece of the services these CBOs offer. Many are human service organizations that also do broader work on Medicaid, operate food pantries, or other wraparound services. And I'll add that we do deploy a few specialized Hunger Solutions staff members to support direct outreach in counties where there is need for additional capacity. But for the most part, we defer to trusted community partners for direct outreach across the state. And just quickly, the resource featured here on the slide is a two-sided palm card with QR code that directs you to a page on our website where you can learn more about NOAP and also to look up where to find support through NOAP in your area. Apart from our broader SNAP outreach work, we also have a specialized team working directly with high-need schools in five New York counties where SNAP uptake is especially low. This program is called the Targeted SNAP Outreach Program, abbreviated TSNAP. TSNAP also focuses on schools nearly eligible for CEP, especially over the last few years of state and federal expansions to eligibility that Erin mentioned. One detail about the TSNAP program that folks on this call might find interesting is that this project is funded by private grants that are also matched dollar for dollar by our state agency from federal funds. So for example, if we receive a $5,000 grant from a private organization to do two SNAP work. Our state agency that administers SNAP matches that with federal funds. Down the line, our goal is to expand the T-SNAP work statewide, and we are currently pursuing funds to support that. T-SNAP has been such a valuable way to pilot different strategies for working with school districts. And one of the key takeaways we've learned through T-SNAP and from decades of working with school districts on the other child nutrition programs is that the best point of entry varies by school district. When it comes to building a relationship with a school, you'd ideally start with a school administrator, such as the principal, or maybe a staff member from the guidance office. But realistically, this isn't always an option. So the best point of contact is whoever would like to help. Someone in your organization might have a connection to the local school district, and that warm introduction is often the most fruitful and is a good place to start. With this context in mind, our team targets a range of stakeholders working within the school system, including food service directors, but also other school leaders such as school superintendents, school principals, and board members. In particular, we hold formal partnerships with statewide membership organizations for school leaders. These partnerships allow us to take a multi-pronged approach to engaging these groups, including through statewide conferences, workshops, webinars, paid advertising, newsletters, and also articles in flagship publications for the membership of these groups. These channels facilitate a two-way exchange of information. We share information about the federal nutrition programs, including SNAP, and why improving participation in their communities is beneficial. And a key focus here is also on helping school leadership see their role in SNAP outreach, how they are uniquely positioned to influence the school system and culture around this program. And at the same time, we rely on these channels to help gather intel from school leaders around their broader priorities and challenges to help keep our messaging relevant. On a parallel track, we're also working to cultivate buy-in from CBOs to conduct more SNAP outreach specifically with schools. The reality is that schools have many competing priorities to ensure kids are learning, that they're safe, and that they have the resources they need, with food assistance being just one of them. We know schools have limited bandwidth and don't necessarily have dedicated staff to conduct SNAP outreach. CBOs can fill that gap. And while CBOs bring expertise in talking with families about SNAP, we see our role as helping to position them with framing and with strategies to effectively partner with schools on SNAP outreach work. So to make the case for why schools are well positioned to conduct SNAP outreach, I'll share a few pieces of framing that we use. First, schools are trusted messengers for their families. We know from talking with school leaders through the various partnerships I mentioned, that since the pandemic, schools have taken on wider responsibilities for helping students and families. Our state's School Superintendents Association, for example, releases an annual survey of top priorities. And for the last few years, it's consistently elevated how families are looking to schools to fulfill basic needs beyond academics. Through the services that they provide, from counseling and healthcare screenings to tutoring support, backpack programs, and so much more, schools are especially connected to low-income families. And in this way, schools intimately know their families and can provide insight on how to best engage. At the same time, it's especially important to help schools see the value of increased SNAP participation as it relates to their broader goals. Cold outreach to school districts asking to promote SNAP can be tough. We find that when we plug it into their interests, such as making CEP work, we're more successful with engagement. And I'll talk more about this on the next slide. We have some specific talking points to articulate why SNAP is a win-win for schools and families, and they definitely align with what Erin shared a bit about at the top of the call. First, increasing SNAP participation helps simplify how school meal programs run. When more students participate in SNAP, it translates to more students getting automatically enrolled in free school meals and less paperwork for schools and families. It also strengthens the financial viability of school meal programming. Specifically, more students participating in SNAP better position schools to offer free school meals to all through CEP and sustain that program over time. This piece has really gained momentum with the loss of universal meals a few years ago and has continued since the CEP expansion and lowering of eligibility. Increasing SNAP participation also helps streamline benefits for families. In a world where families have to submit multiple requests for multiple services, connecting families to SNAP is an opportunity to streamline accessibility to nutrition support and other services. And some examples that we like to highlight include Summer EBT and other supports relevant for families with school-age children, like discounted school fees for band instruments, textbooks, and fee waivers on college applications and admissions tests. Knowing that schools are well-positioned for this work, but face the reality of limited bandwidth, our ask is that they leverage their existing communication networks to effectively spread the word to families about SNAP. And to support schools with this ask, our team created a statewide SNAP outreach toolkit for schools. And we can pop the link for that in chat. This toolkit was designed to provide information about SNAP and its benefits to families, refer families to the online SNAP application for New York, and also connect families to their local SNAP outreach organization. The toolkit is housed on our website and includes a suite of resources schools can plug and play into their existing networks, such as a flyer for families, graphics, which you've seen across the slides that I've shared already, and sample language for social media and other school communications. All are available in both English and Spanish. We also outlined some strategies for how schools can use this toolkit. Schools can be a strong ally by simply adding clear, concise language about SNAP in their existing communication to families, especially in places where families already receive important information from school, like the district website or text, school newsletter, social media, even the cafeteria menu or school-based apps. Schools can also use existing processes or systems to spread the word to families. Some examples that we've seen are bundling information with back-to-school packets and other paperwork families have to complete, or sending a letter to families from superintendents or principals. Schools can also engage their own staff in spreading the word about SNAP. We've seen schools have the main office or front desk staff keep SNAP outreach info on hand to provide to parents and guardians. And other low-hanging fruit to consider are materials that can be sent home with students utilizing school-based food pantries and backpack programs. The bottom line here is to get schools thinking about how they typically communicate with families in their district and then plug SNAP information into that established channel. To promote our toolkit, our talented communications team created yet another two-sided palm card with scannable QR code that directs you to the toolkit homepage, where you can download any and all of the resources I mentioned earlier. I'll add that this resource has been highly popular at statewide conferences since it's so easy to hand off. I'll end now just by thanking you all for your time. My contact information is listed here alongside some other ways that you can connect with our team at Hunger Solutions New York. And if you have any questions about our SNAP outreach work or our approach to any of the other child nutrition programs, please feel free to reach out. There's truly no wrong door, so I'm happy to connect you with others on our team. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Francesca. That was great. I know we're saving questions for the end, but I thought you could just clarify in case somebody else wanted to know. Can you define what CBOs are?
Yes, community-based organizations.
Great.
Thanks for your question.
Of course. All right. Well, next up, we have Chelsea Novak with the Greater Pittsburgh Community Food Bank.
Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for having me today. As she mentioned, my name is Chelsea Novak, and I am the manager of child nutrition programs at the Greater Pittsburgh Community Food Bank. And I'm going to share a little bit about what we do in relation to SNAP outreach with schools. So a little bit about the Greater Pittsburgh Community Food Bank. We are located in southwestern Pennsylvania. We cover 11 counties that are shown here. And we have four different teams that play a role in our work around SNAP outreach with schools. So we have the Child Nutrition Outreach Team. So this is the team that I oversee. And we basically work with anyone who is feeding kids. So this could look like a community organization or a school. And we really try to increase access to the different programs or get new ones started, things like that. So anyone who's feeding kids, we're looking to help them with their work through small grants. We help them to start new things, find new locations for summer food sites. Things like that. And this past year, we provided support to 72 different school year partners. And then we also have a community connections team with the call center. So this team really provides the SNAP outreach in our communities. And then we also have the call center. So if anyone is in need of food resources, they can call us and we can help them to learn about where the food pantries are in their area. We can help them with over the phone SNAP applications, as well as maybe connect them to another resource that they need. And this team last year helped over 3,000 people apply for SNAP. Then we have a marketing and communications team. So this team helps to design any of our print materials or digital materials and oversee our social media. And then we have our government affairs team, which advocates for the different child nutrition programs and for SNAP. So similar to Francesca, we also have a SNAP outreach toolkit for schools. So our child nutrition outreach coordinators work with mostly the food service directors. We do have some connections with guidance counselors. And this is kind of one of the options of things that we can help support a school with. So when we go and meet with them, we can share with them, you know, about this program that they can be a part of and how it can benefit them and their families. And so we usually try to promote this toolkit between November and March. So we usually wait until after the income guidelines are changed in October, and then once we get all of our updated materials. And then we want to try to get it into the schools before April when the CEP notification comes out, so that we can get as many kids signed up for SNAP before that list comes out, so there's more schools that may be able to opt into that amazing program. And the toolkit is basically just a set of files that we send to the school that they can pick and choose which ones they want to use. We have social media posts, a robocall script, a letter, email to families, a food resource flyer, and then a flyer just for SNAP. And on this slide, you can see an example of one of our social media posts. And then here's another example of one of our other social media posts that we have, and then some of the language that the school can use alongside the graphic. There's, you know, different ones based on what they might be interested in, talking about, you know, inflation or skyrocketing food prices, or one specifically that they can use, you know, right after the income guidelines have changed. And then all of the materials point to two different places. One is either our phone number, which is that call center that I mentioned, or it goes to our website, to our link about SNAP. And on there, families can put in their information, their phone number, and we will call them back and either share information about SNAP, see if they're eligible, and if they want to be a part of the program, we can help them get signed up. And then here are two other parts of our toolkit. So we have the robocall script. This can be sent out, just kind of a short blurb about SNAP for the families. And then we have our letter or email that can be sent out to families. And this is a little more extensive. It has a little bit more information on it, kind of like what the process looks like for the same family to get signed up for SNAP. And then it also shows the income guidelines on it as well. So this has been kind of one of our main ways that we have worked with schools to promote SNAP to their families. And then something new that we tried this past year that we really liked and we're planning on doing again is a social media ad. So really our goals around this ad were to provide information on this valuable food resource to families. Hopefully then it would result in families signing up for SNAP. And then we kind of had a new piece to it. We wanted to try to increase the ISP for schools. So we do SNAP ads pretty often with the Pittsburgh Food Bank, but we wanted to try tying in this idea of not only does SNAP help your family, but it can also help your school as well. So we added a second line on here onto the ad, including the information about how signing up for SNAP can also help your entire school qualify for free lunches. And you can see that example there on the slide. And for this, breakfast is free for all students in Pennsylvania. So that's why we only really mentioned the free lunches aspect on here. And so what we did was we looked at all of the school districts in our 11 county service area and looked for some targets. So we picked some schools that had an ISP that was 40 or higher, and they weren't signed up for CEP either district wide or at all, or they were newly CEP. So last year when the ISP changed from 40 to 25 to be eligible for the program, we saw a few school districts opt into it, which was great. So we wanted to help them make it more financially viable by trying to increase their ISP. So we targeted a few of those school districts as well. And basically how it worked was we picked 8 different target school districts and then looked up all of the zip codes that covered that and put that information into the social media ad for Facebook. And then we also told Facebook that we wanted to target parents with children. So that is kind of a little bit about how we set the ad up and, you know, how we chose which areas we wanted to work with. And for it, we had four different visuals. So you saw one on the last slide, and then there's one here. This one was like a movement graphic, so a little bit of a video. So we had four different of these things that showed up. We spent around $800 on this Facebook ad, and it ran for 1 week in February, and then a few weeks later, it ran for 1 week in March. And generally, we saw that it was very successful, especially in comparison to our other Snap ads. So it reached over 73,000 impressions among 23,000 people. And on the ad, there was a Learn More button. So if a family clicked that Learn More button, it took you to our website where the family could put in their information for us to call them to talk to them about Snap. And so there was an estimated of 62 to 120 people who clicked that Learn More button and possibly filled out the Snap interest form. And with this ad, we saw the most success among women ages 35 and older, which is a slightly younger demographic than we see for some of our other Snap ads. And so from talking with our marketing and communications department, they were really pleased how well this ad went. So we were excited to kind of hear from them that it was successful. But I also wanted to see, you know, did this have any effect on the school districts that we targeted? So I looked at the data from the 8 school districts that we targeted. So I looked at January before we did the ad until April from when we were after the ad was finished. And we saw 6 of the 8 school districts that we did the ad in showed an increase in the number of students that were directly certified. And that was totaling 72 more students. So there's no really way for us to know for sure if those 72 students are families who saw our ad. But it is really exciting to see that we did have success in 6 of the districts for them to increase their number of students who signed up for SNAP during that time frame. And one of the districts that we targeted did opt into CEP for this school year. We had been having conversations with them for several years, encouraging them to be a part of the program. And they were able to get their ISP up to a number that they felt comfortable opting into the program. So we're really excited for them to be able to have all the school meals free for their students this school year. So those are the two main things that we've done around SNAP in schools, but we do a few other things as well. So we have backpack programs that we work with at the food bank, and we provide SNAP flyers to all of them to pass out to their families. We've also done tabling events at school open houses and different school events. We have gotten to go to some school guidance counselor in-service days. We did like a tabling event at one of them, and then another one we got to do an actual presentation in front of school guidance counselors to share with them about all the different resources we have around SNAP and how they could be a part, since they are ones that are often hearing about needs of the families. We have Child Nutrition Coalition meetings. So these are meetings that we hold in each of our counties where we bring together anyone who is involved in feeding kids. And we also make sure to share about SNAP in those meetings, and many school districts are a part of that. And then lastly, we have referral links. So any partnering organization that wants to work with us for SNAP outreach, we can set them up with a direct link just for their school district. So Southside School District in Beaver County, Pennsylvania, has done this with us. And last fiscal year, they sent us 43 referrals. So it's a form similar to the one you see on the slide where they give us the information about the family, and then we would follow up with them to share more information about SNAP and help them sign up if they're interested. And so since last fiscal year, we've had a few more school districts sign up. So we're excited to start to see some of those referrals come in and to continue kind of that idea of that partnership with school districts. So thank you so much for listening to me and hearing about this. I'm happy to share about our toolkit and our social media ad.
Kelsey, thank you so much. I love seeing all like the impact data and almost like your process evaluation of the social media ads and all the work that you're doing. So thank you very much. All right, our third presenter is Isosa. There we go. Hi, you take it away.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity to be here. My name is Isosa Udo, and I am a hunger outreach program specialist for Hunger Free Oklahoma. So at Hunger Free Oklahoma, we work by leveraging the power of collaboration to solve hunger in Oklahoma by improving systems, policies, and practices. On the image on the screen, you can see that collaboration is at the core of what we do. So we work with trusted community organizations and networks to create sustainable solutions to solving hunger in the state of Oklahoma. So a little bit overview of Oklahoma landscape. 14.1% overall food insecurity rate in the state, 12.1% in the rural areas, and 10.3% in urban areas. Out of these percentage, 1 in 7 households and 1 in 5 children face hunger in the state of Oklahoma. Totaling 134,000 Oklahomans that are likely eligible for grocery assistance but do not utilize this service, leaving millions of dollars unclaimed monthly. Now I'm going to go over some counties that we are currently working with for the SNAP in School project. So Oklahoma is primarily rural, about 59 of 77 county. So there are 3 counties we're going to be highlighting today that are working with us in the SNAP in School project. And county 1 has 11.8% of people living with hunger, 20% of children in this county are food insecure, and 8% are seniors living in poverty. County 2 shows 1,420 people who are living in hunger, 1,260 children who are food insecure, and 10.8% of seniors living in poverty in these counties. The third county that we are currently working with shows 3,770 people that are living in hunger, 1,320 children who are food insecure, and 13% of seniors that are living in poverty in this county. So a little overview of the SNAP in School project. So due to the high rate of food insecurity as shown on the last slide, a lot of children in the state of Oklahoma are facing food insecurity. This started the initiative with Hunger Free Oklahoma and other organizations taking proactive measures by launching an initiative that is focused on improving access to nutritious food for children. So SNAP in Schools is a collaborative project between Hunger Free Oklahoma, the Oklahoma Human Services, No Kid Hungry, Oklahoma State Department of Education, and select Oklahoma District Schools to help connect eligible households to the SNAP program. Why SNAP in School? Why is SNAP in School important? So SNAP in School comes with the sole purpose of us distributing SNAP and food resource materials in the public school. So we are currently working with 9 school districts right now to connect students and their families and households to the SNAP program. Before we move on, we would like to kind of go over the history of SNAP in School projects in Hunger Free Oklahoma. So our commitment to ending hunger for Oklahoma's children has been the driving force and consistency needed to keep our project moving forward through its various phases. This dedication has shaped our strategies and adaptations to meet the unique needs of different school communities. So a little bit about the history of the SNAP in School project. So between 2018 to 2020, the focus was 4 pilot school districts. The strategy started by working on broad outreach, reaching as many schools as possible. After these 2 years, the findings that occurred showed us that urban schools thrived while rural schools needed more support and customization. So we took these findings back to the drawing board and came up with a plan for the next 2 years on what we would like to focus on. So between 2020 and 2022, the focus included rural K through 12 public schools. And the strategy for this 2 years was using customized messaging and tools testing to share resources to these schools and their families that are present in these communities. So the findings for this 2 years showed lots of partnership opportunities that were available to support schools in these rural areas. So we took that again to the drawing board and came up with new plans on changing some of these focus and strategies to make sure that we are reaching the folks that we need to reach. So between 2022 and 2024, the focus included rural and minority focused K through 12 public schools. And the strategy right now is basically focusing on utilizing school mail data to target outreach and also partner with more professional associations that are present in the communities that these schools are located in. We're getting so many findings right now, but when we have the final one, we would be sharing in the near future. Now we're going to talk about some outreach obstacles. We have faced multiple challenges just trying to connect communities to SNAP or SNAP resources or food resources. But these challenges has also showed us so many opportunities that we can take to be able to provide the right resources to this community. So the first challenge that we usually face or we face is identifying key decision makers within school districts or schools. And one of the lessons learned or what we did regarding this was conduct listening session. And this helped us in building partnership and building relationship with the right people in this community to be able to help us connect the families and their students to the right resources and the resources that we are trying to provide. Another challenge we saw is the timing of the project. There's a lot of staff turnover when it comes to schools, so we're constantly researching what is the right time to reach out or do outreach so we are reaching as much families and households as possible. The letter of agreement logistics. So letter of agreement is basically a form that they have to sign to be able to participate in the SNAP in schools project. So we are constantly working with school folks to make sure that we are connecting them and changing this letter to make sure that we are meeting their needs as much as possible. So we are constantly updating and extending timelines. We're constantly understanding and adjusting the letter of agreement process to be able to meet the needs of schools and school districts. School staff capacity is another challenge that we see, where we are constantly helping strategize a plan for each site that we are working with. Now we're going to go over some current projects that we are doing right now. The first one is the SNAP in Schools Toolkit. We recently started working on this and we are so excited. We have some flyers and posters that are already made and also Color Me bookmarks that will be utilized by schools to share information about SNAP to the student as well as the household. We are also going to be sharing out crayons that has amazing information, including a hotline where families can call into that provides information in various languages to be able to connect them and help them apply for SNAP. We're going to be having a website and newsletter blurb, text message that schools can utilize to send to families to be able to connect them to resources for SNAP. We also have robocall scripts and social media graphics coming up and also web button and so much more. We're really excited about this and making sure that we're constantly helping the schools and the school district that we're working with to make it easier for them to share resources or share information about SNAP, because we know that they're always busy and they're doing amazing work in helping the students and their communities. We're constantly finding ways to make it easy for them to share information. Another current project that we are working on right now is the contracted partners. We're working with three school districts right now, and these school districts have come up with amazing outreach methods to be able to reach students and their families in the communities that they're located in. And this will be ongoing over the next school year. The first district has so many phases and so many ideas. So phase one is basically doing something that will share information to students and their household. So meet the teacher day. So this is a day where flyers and verbal information will be shared out. And this is a day that staff in the schools will be equipped with information regarding SNAP that they can share with families in the communities. Phase two is community outreach. So this school district has come up with a great idea of holding a monthly SNAP day at the library. So talking about the needs, also talking about partner base expanding, and also co-planning events and strategies to be able to share these information to families that are located in this community. So in this school district, current partners include library, Head Start program, literacy council, school system, food pantry, and the health department in this school district. Some success story from this school district shows six leader engaged partner organizations. We've come up with 24 trained SNAP application assistant. So this is an LMS program where folks can go and take the training to be able to help folks that are located in their community apply for SNAP. About 150 plus interest calls and also helping with SNAP application. In 2021, this school district and this community was able to help with 21 application. In 2022, about 49 application. In 2023, 101 application. This is amazing because it keeps increasing. We are really excited to see what this year brings in this school district. The second school district has come up with amazing ideas as well. So their goal is improving SNAP access in the school. They want to come up with a food security advisory board, also known as FSAB. And the members for this board will be including director of the child nutrition program in the school, the SNAP coordinator, community members, the parents, bus drivers, operations director, and SNAP navigators. There's also an idea of people in the school going through the SNAP training that we provide and SNAP education. Also campaigns, holding up mobile pop-up pantry, including the local markets in that community, and attending community events to share flyers and posters and information on SNAP. This school district also would like to help with sign up that will be available weekly or bi-weekly at a fixed location to people or households or families in the communities, also promoting locally and online. This school district also would like to come up with in-school enrollment. So training staff and outreach coordinators that will be available in this school to be able to help with application. District 2 has multiple challenges that include limited access to reasonable price foods, one grocery store in the community limiting access to nutritious food, also traveling for a long time to get food. So it is a food desert. And some of the ideas that this school wants to participate in or activities to mitigate this gap includes cooking classes with meals that are provided in the class, distributing backpacks with food and other resources for families to utilize, lesson plans and reading children's books about nutrition and healthy eating, handing out flyers at various events that will be held in the community. So looking to what the future, what does the future look like for us? The future is working towards universal school meal by implementing Medicaid Direct certification and increasing SNAP applications, and also helping more school meal forms to be turned in. There is a high chance that less students will go hungry. So that is what the future looks like. The future looks like connecting as much household, as much families across the state located in this school district that we're working with to SNAP, making sure that they are getting meals in school and outside of the school. I'm gonna go over some partner voices that shows us why SNAP is important. I know we talked about this already a little bit, but this is a slide that just shows what people in these communities that we work with have said on why SNAP in schools and SNAP in general is important and how it has helped with mitigating the need for connecting children in the communities that they're located in to SNAP and food resources. The first one says that it helps the community by providing a child with access to free food. And also it is important because it connects children in the schools and outside of the schools to food. So this is just to show you how this is something that is really beneficial, and these communities find it really, really important because it helps the children and also their family. I want to say thank you for the opportunity to be able to talk about the amazing things that we're doing in the state of Oklahoma. My name is Isosa. You can connect with me using that email on the screen or the phone number. I work hand in hand with my coworker, LaCrinthia Watts, who couldn't be here today, but you can connect with either of us and we can share any resources and answer any questions that you may have.
Isosa, thank you so much. I love the community voices and just the collaboration that everyone's thinking about, all the different players involved to really promote this work. So thank you. All right, everyone, I'm going to talk very briefly about some resources and advocacy efforts that we have on FRAC, and then we'll address all the questions that are coming in through the chat. So please visit frac.org and navigate to specific program pages to get additional resources on SNAP, school meals, the community eligibility provision, and all the federal child nutrition programs. I want to add a few pages and bring them to your attention. This page identifies the various SNAP, school meals, early childhood, root causes of hunger, all those related bills right now that we are supporting. It also includes information on where we stand related to the Farm Bill and advocacy efforts around strengthening and protecting SNAP and calling for healthy school meals for all. We are in back to school season. I think the majority of the country is in school this week now. So I want to point out our 2024 back to school webpage, which talks about the momentum around healthy school meals for all, CEP, school and after school meals, as well as advocacy efforts around increasing SNAP access for college students. So please join us during this back to school season as we promote a nourished school year. This QR code specifically will take you to one of our letters where you can support or ask your federal representatives to support the Universal School Meals Program Act. Ultimately, our goal is to have healthy school meals available nationwide so that every child in every state has access to the nutrition they need to thrive. The QR code takes you to a webpage. You just easily enter your email, your name, your address, and you can send an email right off to your representatives and encourage them to co-sponsor the School Meals Program Act. Okay, so now I'm going to turn it over to some questions. First off, as Steve mentioned at the beginning of the webinar, anyone who is registered for the webinar will receive a follow-up link that has access to the slides as well as the recording. So you will have access to all of our slides. And if you wanted to reach out to any of our presenters or myself, you know, please contact us and I'll be happy to put you in touch with anyone specifically. There was a number of questions that came in related to CEP, so the Community Eligibility Provision. So one question asked, what is ISP? So when I talked in the beginning of the webinar, we talked about school meal eligibility and how children can qualify for free school meals either through a meal benefit application or a school meal application or through categorical eligibility, meaning that that direct certification, that data matching process occurs where student school enrollment records are matched to participation in other programs such as SNAP, and that child is automatically eligible for free school meals. In schools that are doing CEP or schools that are looking to do CEP, what you have to do is take the percent of students who are directly certified, and the percent, if it's over 25% of the total enrollment, they will qualify for CEP. In CEP schools, and I know this is like federal programs, we talk a lot of different terms here. So we call those students identified students. So the ISP is the identified student percentage. CEP has a lot of technical pieces to it. So I will drop in the chat on the link directly to the FRAC CEP webpage. And if you have more questions about CEP specifically after going through those resources, please reach out. Okay, so I'm gonna bring my presenters back on if you wanna come on camera. So we had some requests for the toolkits that were presented. Are you able to share your toolkits? Are they available on your websites? Can people just go and access them that way? Francesca's saying yes. Chelsea, is your toolkit available as well?
I put a link in the chat. It goes to kind of our external sharing. It's not like hosted on a website, but the individual files are in that folder that I shared.
Okay. And can your toolkit, and just, this is for everyone, the toolkit and the resources, do you think they can be used by other states? Do they include, they're just specific to your states, but how modifiable do you think they are?
I can speak to the New York toolkit. I think it's modifiable to be used in other states. Certainly the graphics, a lot of the images that you saw as I was presenting on my slides come from the toolkit, and those don't necessarily reference New York. Some of the sample language that we have that you could turn into social media posts or plug into newsletters, things of that nature, they reference the online SNAP application portal for New York, but you could take that out.
Yeah, I would also say the same thing for ours. I think the general language can be repeated, just obviously the information of where families would go to get information about SNAP would change, but I think all of our information can be kind of tweaked to whatever you need it to be.
Yeah, it's the same for ours as well. We are currently working on more resources to be available. I think the link should be on the chat as well, but it is a great way to just get ideas on what you would like to use in the communities that you work for. So, for example, you may have to change some specific information, but it's something that you can just take and utilize and change however you feel like.
So does anyone have a one sheet, one pager fact sheet that explains the benefits to school districts to promote SNAP?
We have certain resources that we've utilized in the past, basically showing the benefits of promoting SNAP. I would have to go back and maybe share with you, Erin, and maybe you could share out later on. We also have a video on our SNAP in School webpage where we go over the benefits of SNAP. So if anyone would like the link of that, I could drop it. And you could just go over the webpage to see what resonates and what are some information that we've shared on there that you would like to utilize and take.
Great, and I suppose if you wanna send me those links, we can include them in the follow-up email as well.
Absolutely, will do.
So I know we're running out of time and we have a bunch of more questions. I'm going to just ask one more. And for anyone whose question I didn't get to today, I apologize. Please feel free to reach out after the webinar and we will connect you with the speakers and get your questions answered. But for our final question, for the food bank presenters, how many SNAP outreach staff do you have and how many counties do you serve?
So I can answer that for us. We cover counties in a few different ways. So we have our call center team and then also actual SNAP outreach coordinators. So we have three SNAP outreach people that work in five counties doing the in-person outreach. And then we have an additional three counties that we do the over-the-phone SNAP applications for. And there's a team of five or six people on that call center. So we cover eight counties where we do the applications online, five where we do in-person outreach, and then three other counties that we can do the applications over the phone, but we contract out someone else to do the in-person outreach.
Great. Thank you all very much. We are at 4 o'clock Eastern time now, so that is the end of our webinar. I want to say a big thank you to Isosa, Chelsea, and Francesca for sharing all this valuable information. As always, for anyone who did not get their question answered or has additional questions that they would like asked, please connect, reach out to us. I would be more than happy to connect you with our SNAP team at FRAC or any of our presenters today. Thank you all and have a great rest of your evening.